I would like to start with your presentation this morning. You started it saying that changes in future cities will come not from digital technology, but rather from some primitive forces of revolting, rebellion masses, if I'm quoting you correctly. The question is this. It seems to be a little bit of a contradiction. You are participating in the innovation, technical innovation forum, but you're in a sense saying that those technical innovations don't really count because what counts is the primitive forces. What role technical innovations play in your model of future development?
Well, first of all, I have to agree with the contradiction. To tell the truth, I don't know why I was invited. I don't know anything about technology. I'm not even a low-tech person, almost a no-tech person. The most I do is to make a phone call and eventually write some emails, not more than that. But regarding cities, which I guess are going to be one of the biggest challenges of humanity in the coming years, we've just crossed the threshold of having more people living in cities than on the countryside, which in principle is great news. Cities are very powerful vehicles to improve quality of life of people, so somehow they are shortcuts towards equality. Simultaneously, they are very powerful vehicles to create wealth, so the critical mass of cities will be crucial. And the title of the conversation we have at noon was The Magnet and the Bomb. So cities are these magnets that attract people. People is not stupid. It may be counterintuitive, but people look for opportunities. If anything, cities are concentration of opportunities, not just accumulation of houses. That's why people come to cities and will keep on coming to cities. The problem is that the speed, the scale and the scarcity of means with which we will have to respond to this phenomenon of urbanization has no precedence in human history. So I guess that the forces that will shape the urban environment in that sense are rather primitive. You're looking for prosperity, looking for opportunities. I mean, what explains half of the migrations? It's not just you're escaping a bad situation, you're looking for a better future. It's a rather primitive force. The counterpart of that, the other side of the coin, is that if you concentrate people in space and you don't provide the right housing solution, then of course you create a lot of anger and irritation and resentment. And that's why I talk about cities as this ticking time bomb, that unless we find the solution, we'll create social problems. And these are, again, rather primitive forces. What technology so far, what we have witnessed in our modest experience has made is that, in the first place, it allowed to coordinate that irritation, that anger. If previously you were bitter or eventually, you know, in discontent in your own household, now through technology you can coordinate that anger, and this will more and more mean a major threat for the social political stability of societies. The same way, the same means that enable to coordinate that resentment may channel those forces, and maybe the thing that we will more and more have to respond to is how to include people's opinion in not so much how to answer the question, but in how to define the question. What I would expect from including people in participatory design process in the shaping of the urban settlements is it, what is the question that we have to respond? What are the expectations? What are the desires? And eventually, at a coordinated level, then we provide the answers.
But in organizing this sense of irritation and dissatisfaction, maybe digital technology can play some role. So maybe there is a reason you were invited. What do you think?
Well, definitely it's a role, and I guess that the way to make participation, and again, I'm not We started the participatory processes in social housing in a rather intuitive way. In 2010, after an earthquake and tsunami in Chile that destroyed half of the country, not that we ever were prepared, we didn't plan for that, we were assigned a city to be rebuilt, and we were given 100 days to come up with every possible design for that city. When you have 80% of a city destroyed, it's a window of opportunity that you don't want to lose in case you need to change things that in normal circumstances you wouldn't even dare to think that should be changed. So we just made sure that what we did at the level of social housing was done at this time at the entire city level, 50,000 people in this town in the southern part of the country. And for that, we partnered with a strategic communication company for how to conduct the process. What I heard from them is that participatory processes had to be multimedia. They had a lot of technical terminology. It shouldn't be just on the end. It should be all throughout the process. And when I say multimedia, technology is from the loudspeaker or you go with a car around the street. People, if you are in a devastated area, do not have electricity. So I cannot expect people to connect to the web to be able to know that they have to go to a forum in the main square. You have to go around shouting that you're meeting in the main square. So shouting is technology. On the other end, of course, you have a website, so if you want to accumulate information and process data, particularly if you want to deliver that information to the central government, then the more technology, the better. But I guess this is not one or the other. Still, I think, and I might be using too much my own personal experience, but I do need the hardware, the physical stuff, looking at each other's face. It's crucial for knowledge creation, but if we want to have an understanding, nothing will replace this face-to-face contact. To have the physical piece of paper that you write your vote and put in an urn is still something that you trust. If you're in societies like the ones in underdeveloped countries, where trust is not something that you can take for granted, I mean, to have a piece of paper that you wrote, that you saw that went into the urn is something that is extremely valuable instead of electronic voting. Of course, maybe at a metropolitan scale things change, but I guess that this is the kind of thing. I'm not ideologically oriented, not in the low-tech, off-the-grid, unplugged version, nor having extreme overrated enthusiasm in that technology will make the difference. This was Frederick Price that said in the 60s that, well, it looks like technology will be the answer. But what is the question?
Exactly. So, in other words, you're not a Luddite. You're not for destroying machines like they did in the 18th century in Britain.
Not at all.
By the way, here is an example from the Russian history of a disaster that leads for renewal and rebuilding. Moscow was burned during the Napoleon invasion, and Moscow was all wooden, and it was completely burned down, and that it was rebuilt in a more sophisticated way. So that was another example of a disaster that helped.
Absolutely.
My next question is your website. When I looked at your website and then I looked at your presentation this morning, I was surprised to see an architect's website filled with text. It's so unusual for an architect. We kind of expect an architect to think visually with shapes, images, and your homepage is purely text. Your presentation this morning was purely text. At the same time, you're an architect, you're a member of the Royal Institute of British Architects, you got prestigious architectural awards, you have beautiful buildings. It is a little bit strange to me, but what is your own explanation? Is it a certain opposition to the overabundance of images around us, and you just want to get rid of them? Or is this the way you think? You think with words first and then convert them into shapes?
It's a little bit of what you're just talking about, a little bit of too many images, and eventually that the way to start processes has been is by being able to speak as clearly as possible to identify what is the question that we have to answer. If there's any power in design, that's the power of synthesis. The more complex the problem, the more need for synthesis. If when I draw, if anything, I'm synthesizing forces that eventually are pulling in opposite directions. So our first task and what the way we try to approach a problem is before wanting anything, because that's a very high temptation for architects, that you are so in love with the designs that you're doing that you're looking for a client just as an excuse to push forward your creative agenda. Our approach is as a contrary, postpone what you want as much as possible until you've charged the problem, until you've understood all the dimensions that you should be responding to. Those dimensions, and we talk about an equation, is not because we believe architecture is a science. Actually, there's more one possible answer for the same X. But when you frame, or we talk about the questions, because it's a easy and also very cruel way to verify afterwards if what you design did answer or not the initial aim. So that part of problems that inform the form of a project, this is actually the way we work. I mean, we ask ourselves all the time, what informs the form of a project? Why a building should have this form or another one, a piece of city, this form of another one. The forces that inform the form come from very concrete worlds, gravity, matter, laws, budget, to more intangible forces, desire, character, expectations, and be it very, very measurable or unmeasurable, what we try to put out there is what will be shaping things. About that can be talked, you should talk very clearly. This is, despite I really hate to quote, because it looks like you're trying to give importance to what you're saying, but in this case, there's this philosopher that said it brilliantly, Ludwig Wittgenstein. There are two kinds of things, the ones that you can't talk about and the ones that you cannot talk about. About the ones that you can't talk, talk clearly. And about the second ones, remain silent. Do the stuff. So I guess that this is an attempt that to explain in the most simple possible way what we're trying to do. It's a conversation over the phone that should make sense. That's the ultimate way to talk to communities, to talk to power, to talk to all the people that are involved in architecture. But as soon as that is done in the most simple possible way, that's the jump into the void, this kind of mystery, which is the power of synthesis of design, and you do the thing. And for that, it's just the contrary. You don't have an explanation trying to convince people. It either works or it doesn't. And that's why in that format, an image wouldn't make that much of a thing. I mean, you need to be in space with the thing, with all the thousands of tons that buildings weight, operating or not.
I understand. Can we show the Siamese Tower picture? When you went all this logical way and established all the parameters, at some point your subjective creativity kicks in.
Yes.
And for example, in the Siamese towers, there's an interesting rhythm of the windows. Some verticals are slanted, some are straight, and it's a very pleasant to look at. I'm sure there is no logical explanation for this rhythm. It's just a subjective creativity, right?
Yes and no. I would say that we try to arrive as far away as possible in being logical. But we also know that there's always a degree of freedom. And in that degree of freedom, we try not to mess with ideologies, theories, or even talking. It either works or not. So regarding the Siamese Tower, I don't know if the image is going to show. Actually, in the website, I haven't checked that.
We have this picture. For some reason,
In any case, the story of that building can...
That's exactly. The picture.
So the story of that building, and I can explain up to 95% maybe of the building in a very logical terms, starting with, in a country like Chile, to make things perfect, it's a suicide. So the kind of labor that you get, it cannot work in millimeters like what is expected for glass. It works in centimeters. It's more or less like that. So you introduce a level of noise into the facade, anticipating that you're not going to get regularity. If in Switzerland I try to do a window and try to go out of the system, it costs me a fortune. In Chile, is the other. If I make every single window different, it's the way to enter to be within the budget. So what you see there is the biggest possible window before going into the jumbo size, so still is the most economical size, and actually this slightly tilted. And maybe you've noticed trucks carrying glasses in the city, and even in stores, they're have the slight angle. They're not perfectly vertical because the weight will be resting on the bottom of the glass. If it has up to 4 degrees, then the weight is better distributed. If you go beyond 15, then you have bendings, and that's an issue. So that's somewhere and around 4, where we were able to take 1 millimeter of the glass, and in such a big facade, that means meeting the budget or not meeting it. So out of that piece of glass, we cut it in the diagonal without losing the rectangle shape. And then with that pattern, we cut it in 3. And with these 3 pieces, you can't combine you cannot discover the pattern. So in case there was a mistake, it will be kind of already introduced as a kind of deliberate noise, which, and this I'm not explaining you, I'm glad you said you like it or not. I mean, you feel that kind of vibration or you don't feel it. And this is the kind of thing that we try to be as logical as possible, but from a certain point on, so why the sequence A, B, B, C, A, well, we don't know. I mean, sometimes we change it, it looks better, it doesn't. And this is goes to what we call in the office the unspeakable certainties that guide art. There is a moment where you know the thing, but you just can't give words to it. And it's been said, I don't know who was it, it's like time. We both know what it is. As soon as I have to explain it, we're in deep trouble. And I guess that pretty much the same thing works for design. Unspeakable certainties being the ultimate way to do things.
I understand. So if I understood you correctly, you don't allow yourself to start drawing or creating, so you kind of keep yourself on a leash through the first phase of the project, and then you kind of unleash yourself and you allow yourself to become an artist, basically. Is it a fair description?
Yeah, it would be fair to say so. I would also add that kind of creative thing is like your handwriting. You can't avoid it. It will come anyhow the way you write. So instead of paying too much attention to the way you write, or if you were a tennis player, I mean, if you're paying too much attention to the way you make the forehand or the back, I mean, and you become in love with your style, then you lose the game. I mean, we're focused on hitting the ball as hard as we can, as fast as we can. Hopefully, it will go across the net and within the contraries of the opponent's field. But we're more interested that in the handwriting, in what are we saying with our writing. And so that, in that sense, going back, the text, it's important. The other thing will come out anyhow, and this is that where intuition begins to operate. There are forces of intuition that capture information that you're not even aware to. So what we unleash actually is intuition as one of the most powerful knowledge tools that we have to capture information that we might not even be aware of.
And this intuition, is it something that you get from education, or everybody has it or doesn't have it? So is it something that you are born with, or is it something that could be installed in you by education?
I don't know.
Me neither. I found something very interesting on your site when you talk about going back from archaic technology. For example, when your client wanted a quote-unquote contemporary building with glass facades, you explained that it's very uneconomical and the cost of air conditioning would be enormous, and you replaced it with concrete, basically. And it's very interesting because the desire to have more and more sunlight in residents, people were able to create larger and larger pieces of glass, and then eventually it was a major technological breakthrough when people were able to create those enormous glass panes, and it was understood by everybody like a major achievement. But then, like it very often happens with technological breakthroughs, it became a thing in itself,
right.
And people started repeating it because it became a fashion. And yeah. It's very interesting how you convince your client to replace it with concrete and still look very contemporary and modern. Can you tell
maybe
a little more?
If we
can we have
a
picture of this innovation?
Yeah, innovation, that one. So each of these big windows is 3 stories high, so 12-meter high. So the story about this project is actually quite connected to the other one. The Siemens Tower is maybe 300 meters in the back of this building.
Ah.
It's the same university, and that tower, in a way, in 2005, was the university saying, we want a glass tower. And they say, look, in the weather of Santiago, glass tower is really a bad idea. And we designed a building. It was not a tower. It was a bar out of other materials. And after we had a complete project, they say, but you know what? We want a glass tower. And of course, you're starting your career. It's not that every day somebody wants an important building. And of course, you kind of say, OK, let's do our best. Actually, the glass tower is not the real building. It's just an envelope on the outside. The problem with the glass is that the greenhouse effect, because of the incapacity to re-radiate back the heat that comes from the sun, creates this undesired energy gains. So what we did with that building was it didn't touch the ground, so we allowed to the fresh air to come underneath by convection. Hot air goes up, it's like a chimney, and then it leaves the system before entering the second building inside. So it was the best thing that we could do. When we entered the competition for this building, one of the things that we were really convinced that, well, to do your best might be not enough. And we were willing to lose the project if the client wanted, again, a glass tower. Actually, there was a moment that we were two teams in the final stage, and somebody kind of leaked the information to us that we have lost the project. The other guy won with a glass building. And the reason was that innovation center equal contemporary equal glass. So this is the kind of sequence that the board was in principle following. And we said, look, with the weather of Santiago, this does not make sense. I mean, the energy consumption for a glass tower is at 120 kilowatts per square meter per year. If you avoid direct sun radiation, which is that case, then this is not rocket science. I mean, old adobe structures pretty much use the same strategy. You go down to 40 kilowatts per square meter per year. So our problem with energy is not energy losses, like here, but undesired energy gains. So just by not being stupid, by using common sense, you were able to improve by 300% the system. You don't have to hire a German engineer as a consultant. You just are reasonable, and you improve by 300% the thing. So we knew that we had to have recessed glass, mass in the perimeter, and I guess that the explanation for that, what you're describing as the search for light, I would say that in high rises, it was the tipping point was sometime in around the 70s and the oil crisis. I mean, the real surge was fast construction, you know, reduce the size of elements, so less weight. But Mr. Foley, how much that your building weight, that kind of attitude. Because the faster you could build and the less energy you use in producing the materials, the better. But then we moved on with the prices of energy to keep these buildings inhabitable, and what we lost was the thermal mass that old buildings used to have, particularly in climates like ours, which is actually where the majority of the population will go into cities. It's about thermal mass, not about lightweight. So we said that, look, this doesn't make sense, but of course, to try to convince the client, we use these numbers, but we also refer to the more intangible aspects of what should be part of the question. Namely, one of the biggest threats for innovation is obsolescence. And as soon as you make a building that is too trendy, immediately it will become obsolete. And we've studied architecture. The architecture that is more able to resist the test of time is the one that is more rigid, more neutral, more like this piece of stone is more a piece of infrastructure than a piece of architecture. So instead of contemporariness, we said we should respond to this threat with timelessness. In addition to that, all the corners of the building, you see these big corners are 5 by 5 meters, are the shafts. So it was not just a question of the architectural language. In an innovation center, you should be able to change your minds as many times as you want. If you're on the 8th floor want to put development for a new car and you need to run more pipes, well, you have a lot of space to change time over and over again with the way you're arranging things. And this is some, again, lessons that we gain from old architecture. Clear, pure, austere, even hard geometry is the best way to keep on altering structures so that you accommodate for the uncertainty of the future.
I understand. I have a question about this protruding element. I noticed in other buildings, by you play with those almost like building blocks that children use. In some case, you have a panel like this leaning against the wall or lying on the ground. So sometimes it looks like you are like a child playing with those building blocks. Is this a child in you, or is it something else?
Maybe many things, part of them conscious, part of them unconscious. I mean, I can't talk about the things that I can talk about the other ones I remain silent. But again, we're always looking for the most stupid possible design and try not to have that kind of mannerist, baroque temptation to add more lines. The less lines, the better, because that's the best way to resist the test of time. So in this building, and there's we follow the principle that we say this is a logical but irrational building, in the sense that as soon as you understand the pattern, you don't need to rationalize anymore what's the next move. And for the contractor, that was a big thing. As soon as you explain, well, do this, in the next level you change and you shift the direction of the blocks, he got it in the third floor. And then from the third floor to the 12th floor, it was no need to go to the construction side. And this is very important where coordination is a scarce resource. In addition to that, the abstract character of the building, this kind of austere, even monumental thing, was would, not that we were looking for that, but the reason we knew this afterwards, why we won the competition, is that at some point the board said about the other build that they said, but you know what, this other one is just a building. This is hard to know what it is. Is it a composition? It's a monument. We try to go away from the architectural elements to be as abstract as, possible. That cantilevering thing is that if you have chimneys of the air exhaustion going up, then you immediately lose the abstraction of the thing. So it ventilates to the side. All the exhaustion of those shafts are to the side, and that's the way to avoid the chimneys. But what we were ultimately looking for is that what the compositional principle of this building is not visual, is weight. We wanted gravity. I mean, gravity is one of those forces that you better agree with. I mean, there's many moments in architecture where you're trying to make as if your buildings float. I mean, as if their architecture is light. This building weighs 17,000 tons. If you make it in glass or make it a kind of light building, it will weigh 17,000 tons. I mean, I think it's such a luxury to be able to be given 70,000 tons of matter to be displayed in space that we prefer to celebrate that amount of weight instead of trying to hide it in a building that makes as if it's floating. So the way to perceive the building is not with the eye, it's with the shoulder. I mean, I can't not explain that here, but you go to the place and you feel it here. And this is the kind of things that I guess touch that unspeakable certainty. There's some I don't know, calmness in the thing that we wanted to achieve to be able to agree with the environment.
When Frank Gehry was designing his Bilbao Guggenheim, there was a major technological breakthrough because he used this CATIA software that previously was used for designing jets. And this step that he made kind of opened a whole direction in contemporary architecture, because technically with this software now you can make any squiggle on a piece of paper, and with the help of the software and also with the help of Arup that can build anything, any squiggle you draw on paper, and that opened this path to what people call starchitecture and or egotistical icon buildings. How do you feel about the whole direction and this technological breakthrough? Is it a good thing or a bad thing?
Well, I guess that the way to answer that is being reminded of pertinence. Sometimes for a given problem, an iconic building is the case, is what is needed for that particular problem. Actually, Bilbao, it worked to an extent that is called the Bilbao effect. To create an iconic, never seen before architecture, place Bilbao in the map. It had many consequences on the social, economical development of a region that was depressed. So architecture in that version had ripples that were far beyond the changing of the architectural language. And it was, in that sense, pertinent to do so. But it's not always the case to do iconic architecture. The thing would be to be very rigorous in understanding when is it the case and when it's not the case. Exactly for a country like, or for many places, the kind of technology that is required to do that building may be extremely efficient or may provide services that otherwise cannot be delivered. But the other side of the coin is that we still have billions of people in the world. If there's anything that is hugely available, is hand power. So the low tech, the technique, actually, I mean, going back to a different thing with social housing, when we try to have an impact on the mainstream and not making it just a boutique social housing thing, You go to talk to governments, and they normally, in developing countries, they will normally go for the least technological solution because it employs a lot of people. So mm-hmm. besides providing housing solutions, the unemployment rate, it's low, so the macroeconomic numbers on the country make sense. So for that, maybe the absence of technology is what is pertinent. So what we try to do is to understand for that given question what are the means that are more pertinent to be applied and what not.
In your architectural practice, do you use software for design?
Not for design, or not always for design, mainly for producing the instructions for construction, so AutoCAD.
So you personally design the old-fashioned way on a piece of paper. You don't create 3D models on computer.
We use whatever is available. It's not easy to have an idea, and maybe there's people that, you know, whenever, even by breathing, they, you know, drop out. That's not our case. I mean, so if we need a computer to have an idea, we use the computer. If we need a model, we do the model. If we draw, whatever is available at hand. I would say that the main way to arrive to an idea is to think out loud in a group. I mean, you can take all the computers in the office and even the sketching and the pencil. What you can't take is the discussion among people. There is a group of people that as soon as we begin to discuss this, there, you see the faces. This person kind of makes a funny face, it's a wrong direction, go backwards. That, I think, is the ultimate tool that we use to think out loud in a group.
But to see the expression of their faces, you have to show them something. And my question is, what do you show? Because this morning we had quite a few presentations about new ways of presenting ideas with 3D modeling and things like this. In your company, with your associates, when you have an idea, you want to discuss it with them, how do you show it?
Again, using every possible tool. Sometimes it's drawing, sometimes it's the physical brick, one on top of the other, and you put two bricks together and say, why not this way instead of this other one? And then you feel the weight of the brick in your hand and you understand if it's going to be possible or not. Sometimes it's a physical model of wood or whatever, plaster. And sometimes it's a 3D image. Normally, 3D images tend to be, it's not a recipe, but tend to be when you arrive to the moment to convince a client. When you're on the side of beating the blank piece of paper, you're normally with people that with two lines more or less know where things will end. So you don't need that much of visual information to understand. And again, intuition is important. You make two lines and say, this has a future, and then no way, I mean, forget about that. But eventually, since architecture, it's not that I wake up in the morning with an incredible desire to build a building. I need somebody first to need something, and then they approach us. So since a lot of other hands will intervene into the process, then the visualization tools are extremely important so that we're all on the same page. And in that sense, we believe it's extremely important to have everybody on board. So the end client and the end user anticipates why are we doing today these two lines. And so again, we're very ideologically promiscuous from that point of view.
I see. I'm sure you know the term BIM, Building Information Modeling. It's the software system that allows to take your project all the way through manufacturing and then the construction site. Are you using anything like this after the idea has been developed? When you know what you want to build, do you use this BIM or other software that can take your idea all the way to the building site or through manufacturing if you have to manufacture the steel frame, for example?
No.
Okay. Um, my next question is about this social project. It's called Lobarnechea. How do you pronounce it?
Lobarnechea.
Lobarnechea. It's a very interesting project where you were able to create affordable housing for people from the slums and move them into much better parts of the city, and all for under $10,000 per unit. Of course, you know a famous negative example of social engineering, the Prut-Igo district, that in a sense was a similar idea of providing affordable housing solution for the people, and it was eventually had to be blown up.
Demolished, yeah.
Can we see the picture?
Yeah.
Why do you think Prut-Igo was doomed, and what makes your project different, so you think it's vital and nothing of that kind will happen to it?
Well, I would start by saying what is similar in both two, and it's density. They both achieve more or less the same density, which is about 1,000 inhabitants per hectare. And this is very important, because to be able to build social housing in the richest part of the city, you have to pay for expensive land. The only way to achieve efficiency in the land use is by being dense enough to pay for that better located land, which is the main thing to achieve for a poor family, so that they're embedded in the network of opportunities that cities offer. The people that are living in Barnechea, which is the richest part of the city, used to live in the same river in slums, but despite the awful living conditions they had, all their works, they were maybe gardeners, they were cooking, or they were employees at the supermarket close by, all that network of work was there. A conventional housing solution would have been 2 hours away in the periphery, where land costs nothing, which is not only a disaster for the family economy, also the social network suffers a lot. The children of these families go to a school, a public school, that may be the only good one in Chile. The one in the periphery, forget about that. So for the next generation, it's also a disaster if they have to be displaced. Mm-hmm. So the first aim is to eradicate, instead of displacing people to the periphery, if you just follow the market logic. So in order to be able to guarantee location, density. What's the difference is that density is achieved in low rise, and the other one was achieved in high rise. Why is that important? If you're a rich condominium or a rich building, there's no problem really, because every single tenant will pay the monthly cost of maintaining the elevators, of the lights in the corridor. So if you're rich, fine. If you're in a poor environment, it's not said that you will be able to every single month maintain the elevator, and we talked a little bit in the conversation before. The way the spiral down of those this is already a classic. It's a kind of studied so well. The ones that pay better, that are that all of a sudden kind of are kind of tired, that they're the only ones paying for the maintenance of common services, and there are some that are not paying at all. Those better payers decide to move away, and they're replaced by somebody that has less paying capacity, so nobody will maintain the elevators, you keep on having to walk all the way up, you're assaulted in corridors that are dark, and this is what explains these become ghettos. That's one thing. The other thing is that evidence shows that there's, let's say, the golden number in social terms, that the amount of people that can maintain social agreements, it's around 150 people. Those big blocks tend to have more tenants than that, so as soon as you want somebody to pay what is owing for the elevator maintenance, if you were below 150, you may know that person. You may remember who is who. Beyond that, it's a kind of person that you don't know. You can't, the social control and the social agreements do not operate. So we were very careful when moving to this to maintain the density, but in low rise, with units that are not more than 150 people in one social condominium. So on the first one, social agreements can be maintained, but even in the case it's not maintained, there's nothing common that has to be paid. For the street maintenance, the municipality pays. For the street light, the municipality pays. So we made sure that all the common spaces were paid by the state, and then fragile families from the economical social point of view do not have to take the responsibility to maintain common spaces.
How did you manage to achieve the same density with low rise?
I guess that's the role of design. And then just to give an example, I think it was that case, but the first project we ever did in the north of Chile in 2003, the aim was that there was an illegal taking of land 30 years ago, and there were 100 families living in 5,000 square meters, half an hectare, 1,000 families. And we needed to accommodate them, and if we followed the conventional notion of efficiency along a street, the private lots tend to be rectangular. I mean, if you go to any city fabric, the most conventional notion of efficiency will be along a street, have narrow lots in the front and big depth for the same area, because you can serve with the same amount of street pipes, sewage and everything, more families. That conventional logic in the lot that we were trying to do, introducing this kind of collective space, had one problem. It was very difficult to rotate whenever you had a corner. In a square, you can rotate as many times as you want, and you will be able, I mean, this is a classical problem in the geometry course in the university. Fill a surface with one single geometrical figure. So it could be a most inoffensive formal exercise, but in that kind of knowledge, we understood that we could accommodate more families in this particular place. So we abandoned the conventional notion of efficiency of the rectangular lot, went to what in principle is less efficient, which is the square, but by being able to rotate more freely, then we were able to accommodate more families in the same given lot. And this is how the specific knowledge of design, form making, was used to solve a question that was outside architecture. We didn't do the square because we were interested in the tension of the space. I mean, who can care less about space? And I mean, this is only architects are interested in the kind of thing. To have more families to pay for more expensive land so that the value of the property goes up and they keep their social network. And in order to achieve that, you use geometry, then that's something that we're interested in, that the specific knowledge is used to solve non-specific problems.
I understand. I would like to try to go back to the theme of this forum, which is open innovations and technological achievements. Can you think of any major technological innovations that changed the course of architecture lately? Of course, the invention of the arc in ancient Rome, we know, but a little closer to our times. Were there anything significant technological innovations that changed architecture, even for you who doesn't believe in them?
I would split the title of the forum in two, innovations and technology, or technology equal digital, virtual, because technology is a tool is technology, and you know, a bone a stone is technology. But to my modest experience, and not, I mean, this is what has happened to us, I mean, innovation, absolutely. I mean, the newer the challenges, I mean, you can't answer new questions with old answers. So innovation is absolutely needed. And for me, innovation is the lack of knowledge. If there's enough knowledge, then why innovate? Keep on doing the things that you were doing before. But if the question is new, it's very likely that the knowledge is not there. The thing is that do you go to look for that knowledge somewhere in the future, or can you look backwards? And what we have found so far systematically is the source of originality tends to be in the most common, ordinary, primitive places. So I guess that the question of originality, which is connected to the word origin, is not a chance. You go back to the origin of whatever. I mean, you go to the irreducible aspects of whatever given field, and there might be the reframing of the question. Just to give one example, reinforced concrete seemed to be the outbreak for the modern movement, so that you can have a beam that was composed of compression in the upper part and of tension in the lower part. So you have a rebar, a steel bar underneath that was very efficient to resist tension. We're talking to a couple of engineers, one guy at the MIT, John Oxendorf, and a guy in the ETH in Zurich, Philip Block, and the third party is in Cambridge. And they have this engineering office, and they said that, you know, we're in a fight against bending. We found out that in a beam, 70% of the matter of the cement is not there to resist any kind of weight, but just to protect the rebar from corrosion. So instead of having a straight line in the lower part of the beam, we go slightly above so that we have a slight arch there, and we work just in compression, we can eliminate 70% of the matter. So this kind of outbreak, that if it works out, and they're working in prefabricated panels that are working only in compression with cement, no rebar at all, with 30% of the matter and consequently the energy that is necessary, the amount of transportation that is required to go on site and so on and so forth, well, that outbreak will come from the oldest of the structure that had the arch as a way to only work in compression and not have complex forces at play, which is compression and tension at the same time.
So it will be a discovery comparable with the invention of the arc in ancient Rome.
That's what I mean. We tend to go backward just looking at it with different eyes.
One last question. We're running out of time, even though I would love to continue indefinitely. Some people say that the golden age of architecture, which was a few decades ago, when an architect as a visionary was the main figure in reshaping the way we live. Some people say that that era is over because now, rather than planning new type of an intersection or new planning the city, you can have two programmers in a garage that would invent software that would regulate traffic in such an efficient way that you don't need extra streets or extra intersections. And this morning we saw one presentation about digital control of traffic that can eliminate street lights because it will be by computers just regulate everything automatically. Do you believe in that? In the decline of the architectural profession and kind of giving leadership to digital programmers, people with digital technologies and so forth. One example is the Uber. What a great way of reducing traffic when you can have people sharing rides and you instantaneously you have half of all the cars possibly. But it was not designed by an architect, it was designed by somebody like a programmer.
I have to recognize that I'm extremely limited in trying to anticipate where things are going to move ahead. For now, I just say that there's an incredible amount of need of all the previous ones. I mean, the engineer and the things that are done by itself. But still, I would say that desire is still will be a big driver for. I mean, somebody has to want something, and I. Not because of the arbitrary part of it, but again, because of the intuitive capacity to synthesize how to move forward is still expressed very well and very efficiently through desire. I don't think that any kind of self-replicated system will be able to substitute desire. We are still very physical. And Marguerite Yourcenar in the Adriano's memoir says that stare, that is comfortable today, is pretty much the same stare that was comfortable 2,000 years ago, because our toes haven't changed. So from that point of view, we're extremely prehistoric creatures and will still be. And of course, the complexity of the accumulation of that makes it welcome. Elemental was founded with an architect. My partner was a transport engineer. And a brilliant guy. I mean, and so instead of trying to, this is an architect realm, I mean, the most brilliant person I ever found was an engineer. And so if you cannot come up with something on your own, then partner with the right guy.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting.
You're welcome.